Hachette Audio presents A God in Ruins, written by Kate Atkinson, read by Alex Jennings.
A man is a god in ruins. When men are innocent, life shall be longer and shall pass into the immortal as gently as we awake from dreams. Ralph Waldo Emerson, Nature. The purpose of art is to convey the truth of a thing, not to be the truth itself. Sylvie Beresford Todd. On one occasion, St. George came to a city named Salem, near which lived a dragon who had to be fed daily with one of the citizens drawn by lot. The day St. George came there, the lot had fallen upon the king's daughter, Cleolinda. St. George resolved that she should not die, and so he went out and attacked the dragon, who lived in a swamp close by, and killed him. When he was faced by a difficulty or danger, however great it appeared, even in the shape of a dragon, he did not avoid it or fear it, but went at it with all the power he could put into himself and his horse. Although inadequately armed for such an encounter, having merely a spear, he charged in, did his best, and finally succeeded in overcoming a difficulty which nobody had dared to tackle. This is exactly the way in which a scout should face a difficulty or danger, no matter how great or terrifying it may appear to him, or how ill-equipped he may be for the struggle. Robert Baden-Powell, Scouting for Boys. 30th of March, 1944. The Last Flight. Naseby. He walked as far as the hedge that signalled the end of the airfield. The beating of the bounds. The men referred to it as his daily constitutional and fretted when he didn't take it. They were superstitious. Everyone was superstitious. Beyond the hedge, there were bare fields, ploughed over last autumn. He didn't expect to see the alchemy of spring, to see the dull brown earth change to bright green and then pale gold. A man could count his life in harvests reaped. He had seen enough. They were surrounded by flat farmland. The farmhouse itself stood square and immovable over to the left. At night, a red light shone from its roof to stop them crashing into it. If they flew over it when they were coming into land, they knew they had overshot and were in trouble. From here he could see the farmer's daughter in the yard, feeding the geese. Wasn't there a nursery rhyme in there somewhere? No, he was thinking of the farmer's wife, wasn't he? Cutting off tails with a carving knife. A horrid image. Poor mice, he had thought when he was a boy. Still thought the same now that he was a man. Nursery rhymes were brutal affairs. He had never met the farmer's daughter, nor did he know her name, but he was disproportionately fond of her. She always waved them off. Sometimes she was joined by her father, once or twice by her mother, but the girl's presence in the farmyard was a constant for every raid. She caught sight of him now and waved. Rather than return the wave, he saluted her. He imagined she would like that. Of course, from this distance, he was just a uniform. She had no idea who he was. Teddy was just one of the many. He whistled for the dog. "1925, Alouette.
See," he said. "There, a lark, a skylark."
He glanced up at her and saw that she was looking in the wrong place.
"No, over there,"
he said, pointing. She was completely hopeless.
"Oh," she said at last. "There, I see it. How queer. What's it doing?"
"Hovering. And then it'll go up again, probably."
The skylark soared on its transcendental thread of song. The quivering flight of the bird and the beauty of its music
triggered an unexpectedly deep emotion in him.
Can you hear it?
His aunt cupped a hand to an ear in a theatrical way. She was as out of place as a peacock, wearing an odd hat, red like a pillar box, and stuck with two large pheasant tail feathers that bobbed around with the slightest movement of her head. He wouldn't be surprised if someone took a shot at her. If only, he thought. Teddy was allowed himself, barbaric thoughts as long as they remained unvoiced.
Good manners, his mother counselled, were the armour that one must don anew every morning.
Hear what? His aunt said eventually. The song, he said, mustering patience. The skylark song. It's stopped now, he added, as she continued to make a show of listening. It might begin again. No, it won't. It can't. It's gone. Flown away.
He flapped his arms to demonstrate. Despite the feathers in her hat, she clearly knew nothing about birds, or any animals for that matter. She didn't even possess a cat. She was indifferent to Trixie, the lurcher, currently nosing her way enthusiastically through the dried-up ditch at the side of the road. Trixie was his most stalwart companion, and had been by his side since she was a puppy, when she had been so small that she could squeeze through the front door of his sister's doll's house. Was he supposed to be educating his aunt, he wondered? Was that why they were here?
The lark's known for its song, he said instructively. It's beautiful.
It was impossible to instruct on the subject of beauty, of course. It simply was. You were either moved by it, or you weren't. His sisters, Pamela and Ursula, were. His elder brother Morris wasn't. His brother Jimmy was too young for beauty. His father possibly too old. His father, Hugh, had a gramophone recording of The Lark Ascending, which they sometimes listened to on wet Sunday afternoons. It was lovely, but not as lovely as the lark itself. The purpose of art, his mother, Sylvie, said, instructed even, is to convey the truth of a thing, not to be the truth itself. Her own father, Teddy's grandfather, had been a famous artist, dead long ago, a relationship that gave his mother authority on the subject of art. And beauty too, Teddy supposed. All these things, art, truth, beauty, had capital letters when his mother spoke about them.
When the skylark flies high, he continued rather hopelessly to Izzy, it means it's fine weather.
Well, one doesn't need a bird to tell one if it's good weather or not. One simply looks about, Izzy said. And this afternoon is glorious. I adore the sun, she added, closing her eyes and raising her painted face to the skies.
Who didn't? Teddy thought.
Not his grandmother, perhaps, who led a gloomy drawing-room life in Hampstead, with heavy cotton nets drawn to prevent the light entering the house, or perhaps to stop the dark escaping. The Knight's Code, which he had learned by heart from Scouting for Boys, a book he frequently turned to in times of uncertainty, even now in his self-exile from the movement, demanded that chivalry requireth that youth should be trained to perform the most laborious and humble offices with cheerfulness and grace. He supposed entertaining Izzy was one of those occasions. It was certainly laborious. He shaded his eyes against the sun and scanned the skies for the skylark. It failed to make a reappearance, and he had to make do with the aerial manoeuvres of the swallows. He thought of Icarus, and wondered what he would have looked like from the ground. Quite big, he supposed. But Icarus was a myth, wasn't he? Teddy was going to boarding school after the summer holidays, and he really must start getting his facts in order.
You will need to be a stoic, old chap, his father advised. It will be a trial. That's the point of it, really, I suppose. Best to keep your head below the parapet, he added. Neither sink nor float. Just sort of paddle about in the middle.
All the men in the family went to the school, his Hampstead grandmother said. His only grandmother, Sylvie.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.